Welcome, friends. I am very happy to make another visit to Dubai for a one-day stay here. This is a short visit in transit from India to USA, but I'm happy I could get a chance to see all of you. The reason for my happiness is that we are all co-travelers trying to go on the same path to the same destination. Our destination is our true home. We only come to this path and we only want to follow it when we are tired of this world. If we are not tired of this world, we think we have a good time here, we should continue to enjoy this world. If you have come after a good time you're having in life and no disappointments, you have come to the wrong meeting. This is something that happens to us at a certain time in life when we feel this is a world which is suffering, world which sometimes gives us good times, sometimes gives us bad time. This could not be our true home. When that feeling comes, a certain amount of seeking comes inside us. It's somewhere in the heart, somewhere in the mind. We don't even know where the seeking is. But the seeking is, we want to get out of this. That seeking is very much undefined because it is not like a normal search that we do with our mind. When we want to search something, we know what we are searching, we know where we are looking for it. But the seeking is somewhere inside us. And we cannot really place it where the seeking is. The truth is that in our head, in our consciousness, there are two important factors, important functions going on. One is called a mental function, which is done by the mind. And one is called an intuitive function, which is done by the soul. The soul is not the same thing as the mind. The mind thinks. The mind reasons. The mind makes sense of things. Mind uses logic. Mind works in time and space. Mind cannot work if there is no time. Even the smallest thought takes time. On the other hand, intuition works without time. Intuition works spontaneously. We suddenly get a feeling, what we sometimes call a gut feeling, that we just felt like this, and there is no explanation. Very often, the gut feeling is actually absolutely the opposite of what the mind is thinking, and we don't know where it is coming from. But since we are relying so much on the mind, almost become slaves of the mind, that we reject those intuitive experiences we have, and we just go what the mind thinks. Only next day they say, I wish I could have listened to that voice inside. I wish I had listened to my gut feeling. That these two things are operating differently. The mind does a lot of wonderful things. It's a very good gift. I can't imagine a better gift than the human mind. In order to think, to read, study, walk, talk, do everything under the instruction of the mind. Most useful thing. But it is not useful for going beyond it. You cannot use the mind to say, I'm going to leave you behind so that I can find where my soul is. The soul functions very differently. Soul functions and does those things which don't need time, but we experience it every day. Not only this gut feeling I mentioned, intuitive feeling, intuition, but certain other more important things than intuition happen with the soul. The most important thing the soul does is to have the to generate and have the experience of love, pure love. What is love? When we talk of love, what are we talking of? When we say, I love my house, I love my children, I love my new car I just bought, I love this, that. We are not talking of love at all. We are talking of I, again the mind, being attached to something. It may be house, children, family, anything. So the I is very prominent when you have an experience of attachment, which we call love. But when you fall in love, if you all had experience, at some point in time, we fall in love with another person, and when we fall in love, we don't say, I fallen in love. That thought never comes. We don't even think of I. We think of the beloved who's pulled us. this power to pull exists in love, not in thinking. Thinking has never pulled anybody. Love has always pulled somebody. This special pull that comes, that is a very characteristic thing of love alone and not of the thinking mind or reason or reading or talking. Anything does not do that pull which love can do. Pure love is different from even the definition of love. If you want to talk of pure love, that means unalloyed with anything, without the effect of mind, then pure love is totally unconditional. It has no judgment in it. Supposing somebody says, I love you, but you should be behaving like this. That's not love. You're putting a condition on it. If you are judging, no, you are no good. You have done something very bad. How can you be loved? That is not love at all. Love is completely non-judgmental and completely unconditional. When you experience that love, it is something that pulls you in a strange way. You sometimes cannot even know why it is pulling you. You want to go to the beloved. You are missing the beloved. Why does it happen? It is because pure love has a great pull in it. Now, when we talk of the spiritual path, that means going beyond the mind to the spirit, to our soul. We are talking of something that is beyond the thinking power of a mind. But if we are pulled by love, beyond the mind, we can be pulled. Therefore, the secret of going beyond the mind is to be pulled by love. Now, who can pull us with this kind of love that I'm mentioning, a love that is totally unconditional? Most of us have lived our lives, several lives, only with the use of the mind. And we don't have that experience of love. But there are individuals whom we call perfect living masters. Perfect living masters come us and give an experience of that pure love. They pull us with that love, which is unexplained. We can't even know why we are being pulled. I have mentioned many times an actual story of a professor, intellectual professor, who came to great master Baba Sawan Singh, whose photo you see here was my master, and he said, Master, you are deceiving these people by telling them there is a such God. Why are you duping? There is no evidence. We are scientists. We are rational people. We know there is no evidence that there is anything beyond our body, our brain, and these are functions of the physical body. And therefore, all your talk about higher regions and higher levels of consciousness and going to true home, all false. Please don't deceive these people. Don't mislead them. I've come to tell you that. Great Master said, Professor Saab, you have your own opinion based on your experience. My experience is different. Therefore, we can have different experiences. My experience shows what I tell people is real. Your experience does not include that. We can always have a difference of experience, and therefore, we can always agree to disagree on these matters. But I appreciate your honesty. You honestly told me your opinion. Professor went away. Next Sunday, he was back again. And again said, Master, I've come to tell you that please do not mislead people. There is no evidence existing for what you are saying. It has to be scientifically proved. And there is no scientific proof of what you are telling people. It's just mind can make up anything. The brain can make up anything. These are all ideas, all hallucinations, illusions created by the mind. Why are you misleading people? Great Master again said, Professor Saab, you came last week also, and I explained to you, we can have different experiences. Your experience is different from mine. Professor went away. Third Sunday, he was back again. Again to tell the same thing. Then Great Master said, Professor Saab, I saw you came twice earlier, now you come third time to tell me the same thing. Professor said, I don't know, there is something that says to me, I want to come and see you again and again. What was that? And he got initiated, was one of the best disciples of Great Master. I'm giving an example where the mind was totally talking in a different direction, but the love was pulling totally different direction. And the love was pulling him while the mind was arguing against it all the time. This kind of love does not come ordinarily when we are just thinking about love. It comes when we are not thinking. So that is why these perfect living masters, they don't come to teach us anything. There are lots of teachers in this world. There are thousands of teachers, thousands of gurus in this world teaching how to meditate. Thousands of yogis telling us this thing. This is an unlimited field. People are telling how to meditate, how to find what is inside you, what is below the eyes in the energy centers, what is above the eyes. They are teaching these things. And books are written, thousands of books in every language are available to tell you about this. Perfect living masters do not come to teach us anything. They come to show us the experience of love because we are ready for that love. When are we ready? When we are ready for that love of a perfect living master, when we are tired of the attachments of this world, when we are tired of the relationships of this world, when we are tired here, we feel this is not our place, then they appear in our life. We can't find them. We can find a lot of gurus because they have special costume, uniform they wear, some wear saffron colored, some wear white colored, some wear black colored, some don't wear anything. All kinds of gurus are there, yogis are there, swamis are there in the world. But these perfect living masters do not wear anything. They come like ordinary people like us. In fact, sometimes they are more ordinary than us. What is the reason that they come in an ordinary way? They are born like us, they die like us, they fall sick like us, they get treatments from the doctors like us, they eat the same food we eat. No difference. Their problems, their destiny is like us. Then what's the difference between these people who are ordinary people and we call them perfect living masters compared to the gurus who have got big establishments, who are running big places? What's the difference between them? The difference is these people do not come to teach anything, do not come to draw our attention to anything, do not come to tell us a way and say, that's the way to go, now go. They don't come for that. They come to take us back home. They come to take us back home when we are ready, and the time is for somebody like them to take us back home. They have no other purpose. And they come into our life when we are ready, which means we have had enough of this world, not only this life, several lives. Sometimes we have taken many lifetimes to come to a point when we feel we are done with this experience, we should go. We think this world is real. And that's a very, very easily explained why we think it is real. Because we cannot see any other real thing. We are confined to one reality. That is why we think this world is the only reality. All else is just talk. All else is philosophy. But this world is real. What makes this world real are two things. One, we are blocked from other realities. Secondly, when we test what is real here, we use the means given to experience this world to check that. As it happens, we have been given more than one means to have this world. Supposing the world was only visible through the eyes, we would not be sure if it is real or not. But when I say, are these flowers real? I look at them, yeah, I can see them. I can touch them. I can smell them. I could even pick up a petal, eat them. I have five senses. I can use five senses, and those five senses create the reality for me. That is why the perception of a human being is divided into five perceptions, so we can check with one against the other and say it is real. These are the only two reasons why we are thinking it is real. Now let me give another example. When we go to sleep at night, we have a dream. Supposing I have a dream that I am talking to you exactly like this. And there I am saying, are these flowers real or not? I will look at them, I can see them, I can touch them, I can smell them, I can eat them. All the five senses are confirming they are real. In the dream, I will believe they are real. Because the five senses I have used in the dream are in the dream only. I'm not awake at the same time. I've been blocked from the wakeful state, and only in the dream I'm checking it out. Therefore, they look real. When do I find they are not actually real at all? Only when I wake up in the morning. And that's the only time when I can definitely say that was just a dream, it was not real. During the dream, sometimes we have a dream, we say, I know it's a dream. So many times, many friends of mine tell me they have had a dream in which they discovered it was a dream. I myself have had such dreams also. But when we have the dream, we are telling people, this is a dream. Neither the body that is telling nor the people we're telling are real. Who are we telling? When we wake up, we find that was not the body that was sleeping in the bed, nor were those people real. But it looked real even when you speak the truth. That was the truth. It's a dream. It was a dream. You're telling the truth in a dream. Similarly, if this state of wakefulness, which we are calling real, in which we are talking of reality, and we are thinking this alone is real, maybe when we wake up further, we may find the whole thing was merely a dream. Is it possible to wake up further than this reality? Can we, during a dream, decide how to wake up? How do we wake up from a dream at night? We wake up when we have had enough sleep, or we wake up if a very disastrous dream comes up. We're going to fall somewhere and immediately wake up. Some big disaster is coming, we wake up. Some shock is coming, we wake up. Same things happen here also. That people, it's a kind of a shock with this world which makes people ready for waking up. But that's only one way. It can be a long night and we may be sleeping for a long time. That night is only a few hours. This night may be centuries long. So what makes the other way to come? If a man is sleeping and having a dream, awakened person can come and get up. If an awakened person says, get up, and the man who's sleeping is having a dream. I give example that the man who's dreaming is thinking he's taking his horses back to the stable. He's catching two horses and he's taking them back to the stable. When the man who is awake say, get up. He's half asleep and half he's able to hear the voice of the man says, but what about my horses? And the awakened man says, don't worry, I will hold your horses. And the man wakes up. There are no horses. The man who was awake, when he said, I will hold your horses, was he telling a lie? Because there were no horses. Or was he participating in the dream of the sleeping person and telling something which was part of the dream, but was necessary for that person to be awakened? Perfect living masters are different from us, that they are awake. Even when we see them in a physical body, they are awake to a higher level of wakefulness. A perfect living master is not one who has had some great experience in meditation. At some time when he was doing meditation, comes to tell us what he saw. A perfect living master has not read too many books. A perfect living master is who, when he is appearing, participating with us in a dream, is only participating from a wakeful state. He is not what we see him in the dream. He is a awakened person. And what he has come to, by participating in us, he is giving us a nudge, wake up. When we wake up, we discover that the one we saw in the dream was not the one who was telling us to wake up. The form is different. But we know who woke us up. What kind of form can a human being have who appears human here, but in a wakeful state has a different form? These perfect living masters who are awake when they come to us and we are in a wakeful dream state, their form has been called radiant form, Nuri Sru. So what happens when we wake up, we discover that their form is a radiant form and it was the same form which appeared in the dream just to wake us up. They are participating in our dream of wakefulness. Perfect living masters. are not only awake at one level, they are awake at every level. What are the levels at which one you can wake up? The levels that are known from those who have woken up to that point and they describe it, they are all given in the books also, because it is a known way that we can wake up ultimately to the level of our true home from where we have come to this world. So what are the levels? First level is where we are sitting right now, called the physical level. And this body is called the physical body or asthul sharir. In the dream, you can have a swapan avastha and can have a swapan sharir also. But in the wakeful state where we are sitting now, this is the physical level. And the physical body, what does it consist of? The physical body consists of matter, physical matter. And in the physical matter are working sense perceptions. The power to see, power to touch, power to smell, power to taste. These five senses are operating while we are in the physical form. They are not part of the physical body, because when the physical body dies or is unconscious, we can't use these five senses. Body is intact. There is no change in the physical body. Therefore, something else is inside which makes those five senses in the body operate. Can those five senses operate on their own also? Do they operate if we don't have a body? Well, there must be some way to test that. I'll come to that little later. But inside this, the sense perceptions, there is something else that makes us think, that makes us make use of perception and divide it into five sense perceptions. What is that? We call it our mind. So this physical body has sense perceptions inside it, and it has got a mind that thinks inside it. What else does it have? It has life. It's alive. Mind is working alive. Senses are working alive. Body is working alive. We are alive in a dream. So life is coming from inside the mind. So this is a good combination, that we are now sitting with all these things intact. Now, is it possible that we can see them separately? It is said that when you die in the physical body, this body is dropped dead. But something else remains. Some people have given experiments of near-death experiences. People say that you can have, there are ghosts, there are spirits moving. Some people are telling me, my mother died in this house, I can still feel she's moving around. That's a feeling. Is she actually moving around? There are many experiences. People say she even puts on the light by itself. She does this thing. Actually, there's a friend of mine in USA, and he suddenly was looking for a house, and the realtor said, there's a very beautiful house, and it's all furnished. And the lady who owns it just died. Her children are living very far away, so they want to sell the house at any price. It's a wonderful bargain. So my friend, he bought the house. When he found the house was fully furnished, even some computer she had bought had not been opened from its package. So it was a wonderful bargain. But there was a rocking chair. When he would come, sometimes he would see the door is locked. When he opened, rocking chair was moving on its own. So he said, is there a ghost or something? Is some air something? He checked many times. Then he would go into his bedroom. The door would open by itself a little bit, like somebody is opening and looking from outside. He told me that I think there is some spirit here, some ghost here. So I said, who could possibly be there? It must be the old lady. The old lady had built up everything, hoping her children will take care of it. Children didn't bother at all even to come to see the house, and they disappointed her so much, she still wants to be there. So that is why the lady is there. Several experiences, put the light on, put the TV on, things that are not possible for his invisible spirit to do, but happening in the house. So he said, I am very bothered by this. I can't sleep at night. I'm trying to sleep and somebody just opened the bedroom door. I don't like it. So my wife and I said, we'll come and help you. So we went to his house. He said, tell us something favorite where you feel moving. He said, she sits in this chair or some piece of furniture. We said, put the furniture in our car. So we got the furniture in our car, brought it home, and there was no movement of anything, no opening of door. Our door began to open, and our chairs began to move. So we knew that the lady's spirit has come here now. We brought her because she's attached to the piece of furniture. A simple attachment bringing her here. So we had a house in Bruce, Wisconsin. We are building an auditorium to have our meetings there, and my wife had a house there. So we said, let's take the lady to a nice place up in Bruce to Wisconsin. So we carried her in our car by a piece of furniture to which she was attached. And when we put the furniture there, it made it like a mental piece, and things began to happen in Bruce. And nothing happened in Chicago. So we said, that's very good. We were very happy we came back, left her in a nice, wonderful place. After 2 months, that friend of mine says, she has come back. I said, naturally, she was left alone there. So she didn't like to be alone. Now, I'm just giving one example. I have met a lot of people who have experiences like these. So that is why there is something invisible we can't see. Does the person who has died, whose body has gone, has something left over that can move around? Why make a guess? Let's see if we can simulate an experience. Just copy the experience of death. How does death take place? At my age, I'll be 93 in a few days, I have seen many people dying. I have gone to hospitals. My own colleagues, my own friends, they have passed away. Some I have seen dying in terminal illnesses, and I watched them actually die. When they die, they don't die suddenly at once. First, they don't know where their hands and feet have gone. Then they don't know where the arms and legs have gone. Then they don't know where the bottom of the torso is gone. Then it comes up. They're still talking. They say, please put my leg on that side. It's already on that side. They become unaware of it. Then when they become unaware up to the heart, they can't talk. They try to talk. I've seen that. And the eyes are moving clearly. When it goes up above the throat, even eyes become still. When they go through the eyes, they're dead. There's nothing left in the body. It's disposed of. They're gone. Who has gone? What has gone? People say, oh, soul has gone. They have no idea what soul is. Never seen any soul. And we're just making such a big guesswork, some soul has gone. That's not true. But can we, while we are living in this body, have that kind of an experience which a person has during actual death? So this is where the experts who have tried it out tell us, yes, we can simulate, actually recreate the same experience which people have when they die while we are living. So we can die while living. So they quote scriptures. Even Paul says in the Bible, I die daily. So he's referring to an ability to have an experience of death before dying. That's useful because when you die, you can't tell anybody unless you're opening doors or rocking chairs. There's no way to communicate. Maybe those people who have died are shouting at us, but they can't use the voice, material voice. We can't hear them. We think they've gone. We are missing them. The more we miss them, the more they open our doors. The point is, can we have that experience? So these experienced people tell, yes. How do we do it? First, we determine that if we are living in this body, and we are not the body, we are life. We are consciousness, we are awareness, we are what makes us know there's a world around us. Where is that consciousness, that ability to be aware, operating from in this body? is it operating from the whole body or from a certain part of the body? We know that the hands and feet are merely attached to us and we use them, but we are not thinking from there, we are not asking questions from there, so we ignore them. We come up to the body. It doesn't take more than a few minutes to realize that all the thinking, all the thing that we are looking at is coming from the head. This small part of our body, can you imagine? What are the main senses we are using? Seeing, most important. We see the world, and that's why we know we are alive. Seeing is from the eyes. Hearing is next most important. To listen. Listening from the ears. Smelling from the nose. Taste from the mouth. And the most sensitive part for touch, the tongue. All this in a small area in this body. This is the most important part of the body for having experience of the world. So that is why we can very easily know, if we want to investigate where are we operating this body from and using our sense perception from, it's a very small area of the body. Then we can go further. Are these sense perceptions creating the experience of thinking, experience of questioning, experience of using our mind? We narrow it down to go further within a small part of the head. If the part of the head from where we are operating is so small, then we realize that the ears and the eyes are exactly at the level from where, if we close our eyes, we are trying to look out, we are trying to think, the whole thing is being done from a very narrow strip of the body here. The eyes, ears, that's a small strip. Above, there must be something in the brain, but our actual experience is happening only in a small strip of this head. Then what do we do? Let us see that if we close our eyes and say, am I alive? Where am I? Not the body. We're closing our eyes. Am I alive? And if so, where am I? The answer will be right from where you're trying to look out, behind the eyes. It's a very important step to take, that if you try to figure out where you are operating this body from, that you are operating from some point behind the eyes. And how far behind? If you contemplate more, not completely to the back, nor in the front. You are somewhere in the middle. Best way to describe that middle point is, it is between the ears, behind the eyes, between the ears. If you draw two parallel lines behind the eyes and one line across the ear, you find exact spot from where you function. Because the two eyes that are looking out do not see the same picture because they're separated. And if you want to put your finger in front and look at a distance, you see two fingers. If you look at the finger, everything else behind becomes two. Because the two eyes are seeing two different things. They have 3D movies. They give us special glasses to make the distance appear. How are we making the distance appear when the two eyes are seeing different? Where are we combining without any glasses? Where are we combining the two images that the two eyes are seeing, and we are seeing only one image outside? Where do we focus this from? Where does the one image come? If you contemplate that, it comes somewhere behind the eyes, in the middle, not on the side. Now, if you take all these things together, you will find we are talking of a single point in the center of the head, behind the eyes, between the ears, and that has been called the third eye, the third eye center. It's been called the third eye because that's the eye that actually sees, even when we're using these two. That's the eye from where we think. That's the eye from where we operate when we are awake. So it's very useful information. And little contemplation and meditation or thinking about it can generate this awareness that you operate from there. It's a very useful knowledge to get to know that your whole life, their experience of life, is operating from a small area, and the center of that area is behind your eyes. then we can use some beautiful gifts given to us. Human beings have some beautiful gifts given to us. One is called imagination. We can imagine anything we like. We can imagine we're sitting on top of this house. We can imagine we are running here. We can imagine we are flying. Anything we like, we can imagine. And that's not real. It's imagination. But we have the power to generate an experience which can be multiplied into all the five senses. We can imagine we are eating. We can even taste. When I conduct some meditation workshops in the United States, I make people imagine that there is a flower, the flower inside. Imagine you are watching flower, you are imagining there's a food there, imagine you got something. They are able to see, able to smell the flower, able to taste the food. They're able to do everything that we do with the physical body, with their imagination. That means whatever imagination is, it has the capacity of generating experience of all the five senses. That's very interesting, that what we call imagination or unreal, something unreal, has the capacity to create, generate what doesn't exist. It generates through imagination the experience of the five senses. So supposing now we imagine that we are there inside at that point. We don't want to concentrate or make ourselves small or something to put ourselves there. No, if you do that, then you're still in the same body, just trying to put something in part of your body. Not like that. You just close your eyes. When one closes his eyes, there's a space. It is the same space that is outside is now not visible outside. Space is inside. Supposing you are not sitting on a chair, but sitting in that space. Not difficult by imagination. You're sitting on the chair, close your eyes, there's all the space, you just lifted yourself up there. Not small being, the whole of you. The whole of the physical body is now in that space, dark space, behind the eyes. Where are you doing this from? From the same third eye center. There's no other place to do it. People are telling me by reading books and following some written instructions or listening to people, we are searching for our third eye center. I said, do you know what you are searching? You are searching what you already are at. You are here and you are saying, I want to find out where is here. You cannot be awake, cannot look outside except by being at the third eye center. What are you searching for? We cannot operate in this physical world without being at third eye center, and you are looking for third eye center. When you start looking for something, you move away from where you are. We are supposed to find our own self where we are operating from. That is why this is a very big mistake people make, that we have to search some spot. No searching. Close your eyes, lift yourself up, and you are at the third eye center. Now, if you are at the third eye center, what else can you do? Another gift given to us is we have something called attention, tawajjuh. We can put our attention wherever we like. We can imagine a whole house, but we can put attention on a corner of it. You are sitting here with me, I can put my attention on these flowers. I put my attention on the photograph of my master. When I put attention on something, what happens? That very interesting feature that we have. It's a gift, very big gift to us, that when we put attention on something, we have the ability to concentrate our attention. That means narrow down our awareness to wherever we are putting our attention. If we concentrate our attention on anything, we become less and less aware of what is around it. That's the secret. The whole secret of self-realization is the simple thing. The power of imagination, the power to use attention, the power to concentrate it. If we use these three things, where? Where we are sitting behind the eyes. Whole secret. If we put attention on the fact we are sitting there in the darkness, For a while, we still feel that the eyes of the physical body are in front of us. But supposing we start functioning there, that means we make a cup of tea there and sit in a nice chair and begin imagination. We begin to work, do everything over there. We take a walk there, we run there, we do everything inside the darkness. What will happen? If we put attention on activities there, we will gradually not know what is happening outside. That's normal. If we put more attention and more activities there, do things, singing songs, dancing, whatever we like to do there, we will not know where our hands and feet have gone to start with. We won't know where the legs and arms have gone. We won't know where the bottom of our torso has gone. We won't know where our heart is. We won't know where the body is. Exactly the same thing that happens when your person actually dies. What a great way of simulating, copying actual death by a very simple process for which the gifts have been given to us. Imagining you are behind the eyes, putting your attention on doing everything there, concentrating your attention there, and you succeed in becoming unaware of what is out, unaware of the body. But imagine now, if you are active, very active, doing everything with sense perceptions, with thoughts, with life, you are alive, with thoughts, with sense perceptions, no body. What will be your life like? What will you feel? You feel you're completely light. What is making you heavy is a matter, material thing. Imaginary self has never got any weight at all. Then you start flying, you go into the sky, you see lots of things, and then you compare. How does it compare what I'm seeing with what I was seeing when I was in physical body? Then start comparing. You will see, well, when I was in the physical body, at night it got very dark. But there it doesn't get dark. There's a big difference. I could not fly with a physical body. I can fly because there's no weight in me. It's so easy. But the most extraordinary thing that happens, which is the greatest evidence that you need of the existence of that inner self, that you begin to remember things with your mind. When we have the physical body, when we try to remember something, use our memory, we confine it to the memory of a physical self. When I was a child, it happened this. Last year, it happened this. Constantly thinking of what happened to the physical body. What happens when you start thinking what happened to that body we are talking of now? Which can fly, which can be anywhere. What happens? You remember what you were doing 200 years ago. What you were doing 500 years ago. You weren't even there. This body wasn't there. How can you remember your own thing by sitting in that body without awareness of this body, which happened so long ago, and you don't say that I'm just remembering something from the physical body. It's a memory of that self. There you find out, first time, convincingly, that that self which you are using and remembering existed before this body was born. That's the greatest proof one can get by a simple process. I call it real meditation. Real meditation is to meditate upon the self. Whatever you think of the self, where you are living, where you are aware, put your attention on the self and you can recall things that happened before the body was born. Thereby showing that what you thought was an imaginary body, through memory, you discover it was not as imaginary as you thought. Then why do we think it is imaginary? It's one reason only. We think this is the only reality. Everything else is imaginary. We are so much into this reality that we cannot think of any reality except when we become unaware of this reality. Then only we found that's more real, longer lasting. Our self was longer lasting. That self which we start off from this body as an imaginary self becomes our real self. The sense perceptions, all the five sense perceptions are very sharp in that body. Have you ever tried Now, people at my age, they got bad eyesight. I have to use glasses to read. See, my new glasses I got. We have to use these inside with your imaginary self. No matter what your eyesight, you can read the finest print, read a newspaper inside without problem. You can smell flowers so deeply you never can smell outside. You can see flowers changing colors, becoming beautiful with luminous with light coming in them inside, never see outside. You'll be surprised that what we thought was merely an exercise in imagination turns out to be a much deeper experience of our sense perceptions. And then who is having that experience? Not somebody else, the same self who is now sitting in this physical body. When we go to sleep and have a dream, it's a different body. Who is in that body? The same self who in the wakeful body. In the wakeful body. You'll be surprised if you do these practices to discover different forms which you take at different levels of your awareness, different levels of consciousness, that the self remains the same, no matter what. Bodies will change, forms will change. You will always know it's the same self who was the physical, who was in dream, who is in the imaginative self now. This imaginative self is not imaginary at all. It is more real than this. We discover its reality when we withdraw from this reality. The longer you can stay there, the more real the whole world becomes that you are looking at. It's a different world. But sometimes you are able to see things that are the same, that are physical. You'll be able to move around in the physical world, and at the same time, you're not physical. That is exactly what these dead spirits are doing in the house of my friend, and they later on my house. They are just the whole thing, same being, without the physical body. What else is there? Astral self or the sensory self, the same mind, same soul, same life. Nothing else has changed except the physical form. Therefore, to say that the physical form is the only reality is only while we are shut off from them and we're considering reality by using our five senses. Is it necessary to use five senses to determine reality? Well, it is necessary here. It is necessary in the dream. It is necessary in the imaginative self, or the what I call the astral self. That body with no matter is called astral self or suksham sharir. The suksham sharir has all self-perceptions, same mind, same soul. Can we have another way of discovering that sense-perceptions are not necessary for determining reality? Yes, there's another way. A better way. A deeper way than doing this. The deeper way is to do the same thing we have done with the physical body, to withdraw its attention from the physical body and go to the astral self. Astral self has the same form, similar form as this body. We feel we have a head there, we feel we have eyes, we feel we have ears, we feel we have everything. Or when we imagine ourselves, it's exactly the same. Sometimes a little variation in size, there may be little variation in face, sometimes a lot of variation in face also. During some of the exercises we do in meditation, I tell people when they're sitting inside behind the eyes, I tell them, imagine you have got a mirror in your hand and pick up the mirror and look into it. Naturally, they imagine they pick up the mirror, they should be seeing the same face they see in the physical body. Faces are all different. How is that possible? By the way, sometimes girls take up the mirror and see a boy inside. And boys pick up mirror, see a girl inside. And that changes while you are watching the mirror. Forms come and you can see the form is of yourself, not of somebody else. It's not what you saw in the physical body. How do the form change? Through memory. As you remember long ago, the form that are appearing in the mirror, in that self, astral plane, are your own forms of past lives which you took. Can you imagine with such a simple exercise, you can see your faces that you had in past lives? In every meditation workshop, it happens that I do it. So that is why these are not very difficult exercises. If you want to go deeper than this, then meditate upon the third eye center of the inner being. The one that you've now discovered without body, without matter, meditate within that. Little more difficult. Very few people have done it, by the way. But the few who have done have had beautiful experiences. What is the experience if you were to withdraw your attention even from what you are considering is a body with sense perceptions? When you place yourself behind the eyes of the inner self and withdraw, gradually you lose awareness of your sense perceptions. But you perceive everything. You know everything. You know, and surprisingly, you say, am I seeing light or am I hearing music? You can instantly see music, instantly hear light. They were never separate perceptions. We divided them to create the experience of reality at a lower level. What level have we reached if we can withdraw ourselves even from sense perceptions and still have perception complete? What is running at that time are thoughts, thoughts generating perception. We discover what we have come to is a still inner self of ourselves, which we have been calling our mind. It's the mind functioning, generating everything directly. So the mind can function only by itself. What else is in the mind? The same self. There's a physical body, same self that was in the astral body, same self in the mind. These are achievable experiences. This need deep meditation. It's a much deeper meditation to meditate from your inner self. But it can be done. If you're serious about it, everything can be done. You discover such wonderful things at that level which are unbelievable here. For example, you discover, the more you stay there, the more you discover how time and space are created. From a single unit, it's spread out. All events put together are being spread out over timeline and whole patterns of life being created. How so-called life's patterns, how we are born here, what life we have, what events we have, all being created. That all available right there. It's undescribable experience. The other undescribable experience is that we are able to travel on what we have called time here. It looks very funny that we are sitting in time and space. The scientists are telling from Einstein onwards, they are saying time space is one unit. Time is merely an ordinate of space. Any way to prove it? No. Because if it was the same, in space I can go there and come back. Why can't I go in time and come back? This is a very big problem the scientists are facing today. That if time-space is a single thing, a continuum, a simple way to describe events, then how come we can walk in space and come back and we can't go tomorrow and come back to today? It should be equally possible. So many new experiments are going on to determine how come that we can't move on time the same way in space if it's just an ordinate of space. It is not. But we can find that the time as we know it is not operating the same way everywhere. For example, in your imaginative self or the astral self, if you like a scene very much, you can hold it. You can't do it here. Time cannot be held here by any reason. Time will flow in one direction only. There you can see in the astral plane, time can be held. If you like a particular scene, we used to play a game as children called freeze. And everybody, whatever position they were in, had to stop like that. That is just a game. But in the astral plane, it's a reality. That if you like a particular thing, you can hold it for as long as you like. So time is very different in the astral plane. What happens in that higher plane, mental plane, or what we call causal plane? And this body we call a sthool sharir, physical body, the inner one, we, sensory system, we call sukshma sharir or astral body. Now what we have come to the mind, we call causal body, karan sharir. Why is it given this name? Because we discover all experiences that we have ever had in the physical and astral self were generated there. That's the cause of all experiences, cause of all creation. Any creation that we have ever talked about, written about, is coming from there. That's a very big experience to discover the reality of that place. It is lying within ourselves, accessible to us, merely by becoming unaware of two levels surrounding us, surrounding the life that we have. Now we come to the third level that surrounds us and is so powerful, because everything generated in time space is coming from there. That is why so many very highly evolved masters I have met in my life, they are called Sadgurus and worshipped by people, and they are describing that state as true home, Satchkhand. They say because all life originates from there, therefore that's the place. Of course, religions are describing only the first stage as our true home. They describe the heavens that exist. Heavens and hells, what we talk about, places of great pleasure, places of great torture, are only the astral plane. Religions are calling the heads of those heavens in the astral plane as God. Ishwar, Parmeshwar, Allah. We are all worshipping them as the creator. They are the creator of this universe. But the creator of the creators are at the causal plane. And very few people have even reached there. But they say since everything has come from there, that must be the end. How can there be anything more? The beauty of that place, like I said, here we have night and dark. There we don't have. In the causal plane, the sky of that plane changes color. It becomes a golden sky. Orange colored, golden colored sky. If you have seen a setting sun, when the sun is setting, you can easily see it before it's too hot and too bright. If you see the setting sun, stretch that sun all over the sky, that's the causal sky. Some people in meditation accidentally just get a glimpse of it also. Many have described that we just saw it for a little while. Because the attention can slip anywhere. The attention, our attention is the secret. Where the attention goes, that experience we have. Glimpses people have of many of these areas that I'm describing to you. But the universal mind, which is discovered at the causal plane, is just one big mind, one big machine. And our mind, what we are using here, is merely participating in the big mind. And we think we all have our separate minds. We are all utilizing the same mind. There's a big discovery. These are very big actual experiences. They are the most dramatic and wonderful experiences I can even think of in meditation, deep meditation. And yet, I must confess that we have nowhere come to our true home, because we have nowhere discovered our soul. We have nowhere discovered where life comes from. Life does not come from the mind. Life does not come from the senses. Life does not come from the body. Where does life come from? What are we calling Atma as beyond these three regions? We have not discovered the Atma at all. And yet we have landed up there, and therefore we worship the mind, because the mind creates everything. Now we have to find out what creates the mind. What creates real life and making the mind alive, makes the senses alive, makes the body alive, makes dreams alive. What is that life? Where does that lie? There is no meditation that I know of that can ever discover that. Sorry. I've tried lots of meditations in my life. Unbelievably large number of meditations. Every kind of hatha yoga, kundalini yoga, all kinds of yogas of the six centers of energy, several centers of going behind the eyes and discovering. No meditation can take you beyond the mind, for a simple reason. All meditation is done with the mind. Every time you meditate, no matter what meditation it is, you're saying, I am going to do this. Then I is there. I am going to do this. You're talking with the mind. You can't use the mind to go beyond the mind. Therefore, what happens then? How do we find your soul? I started by talking of these perfect living masters. Then they come into our life. They use a method that works for us to find our soul. Love pulls. Effort pushes. Love pulls, effort pushes. All meditation is effort. Love is not effort. So the love pulls. Now we don't want to be pulled into the words to another human being. Another human being is pulling us. We are staying more in this world. We want to be pulled beyond the mind within ourselves. We want to be pulled inside, further within even the mind, even the causal body. What can pull us from there? What exists there? It's assumed that at least life will exist there. Soul will exist there. Atma will exist there. So maybe we want our soul to pull us with love. An experience of love that should be there, experienced by the mind, experienced by senses here and physically here. We have no idea at all. We haven't even gone one step. How can we discover what will pull us there? Here comes the role of what we call perfect living masters, ordinary human beings, like ourselves, appearing in our life. No difference. Same problem, the same destiny they are carrying like we are carrying. They are living an ordinary life like us. But one difference. Whereas we, with great difficulty, withdrew our attention to discover the wakeful state of the astral plane, they are awake when they are standing and walking with us. They are also asleep in this body, but they are also awake. Sometimes you have daydreaming. They are daydreaming of this physical body. They are also awake at the causal plane. They are also gone, they're pulled beyond to the soul. Not only that, they have gone beyond the soul to where our true home is, totality of everything. Where our true home is, it is so complete and total, there is nothing outside of it. What we are experiencing here is all being generated and experienced there. But we have been cut off from that awareness and we think they're all separate. They're not separate. Every type of life that we're having, different stages, different forms, they're all together in our true home. If you are in your true home, you have all the experiences at the same time. These perfect living masters are operating with their awareness in totality. Therefore, they are not only aware of what is happening there, they are aware of what's happening at the soul level, they are aware of what is happening at causal level, aware of what is happening at astral level, aware of what is happening here. What happens when you go to the total? In the totality, you find we are all one. It's just one consciousness. It's one life. We are all participating in one life. We're just separating ourselves for experience. No other reason. I give example from a glass of water every time. Here's a glass of water. One glass of water. Could I say these are so many drops of water all put together in the glass? I could say that. Supposing I want to see the drops in this water. What do I have to do? Instead of seeing the whole glass, I'll concentrate my awareness to a small part. There's one drop, there's another drop. I can see all the drops. How many are they? Is a big drop, there are thousands of them, they're very small, a million, there can be trillion drops. How can I make the same glass of water to trillion drops? By simple method, contraction of awareness to one smaller unit. Our soul is nothing more than a contraction of awareness of our totality. We are truly one by contracting ourselves in awareness alone. We become souls. Was it necessary to do that? Wasn't totality good enough where everything is there? The necessity for division or contraction came because the qualities of totality, whatever they are, we know one big quality was what we have just spoken of, love, prem, prayer, one big quality. People are often saying, God is love, without knowing what they are saying. If God is love, is God a lover or is love? If there is only God, he can't be a lover. He can be love. Love is a quality. Lover is a function, an experience. To make something that's a quality of knowledge, is it shared knowledge or just knowledge? If there is total gyan, total knowledge, total awareness, totally unshared in one totality, it's not an experience of any kind. If you split them, make them small, you generate lovers and beloveds. You generate knowers and those who give knowledge. The whole division into souls has taken place only for that reason, to make that which was the truth into an experienceable truth. So it's so wonderful to see the creation, the division, and the whole process of generation of these different levels of awareness, different levels of experiences for us is all to enhance the experience by division. That is why we are so many. We are so many, we can experience love, knowledge, bliss, joy, happiness. This is all existing in our totality. But there must be something else existing in totality. If we look at totality from here, it's a blissful, happy, joyful place. There's no pain. There's no suffering there. It's not complete in a way. Seen from here, it's not complete if you're going to see all beautiful, good things. What we call here an area of duality, area of non-duality. Our true home, let's say, is non-dual. There's nothing opposite there. Whatever it is, nothing opposite. And here, we have generated an experience in the three worlds of pairs of opposites. Everything we are experiencing here is based on opposite. Starting from the microscopic electrons and microns, they're all based on electrons. Negative, positive, everything here, night and day, darkness and light, happiness and unhappiness. No experience is available here without its pair of opposite. So we are living in a world of duality. And our true home is non-dual. We can't appreciate non-dual if the whole appreciation is coming by generating an opposite. What a clever way to generate an experience, a whole world, several worlds of duality, which become the opposite of the world of non-duality, thereby we created an opposite. This was just a creation. That's the reality. And the reality has become more appreciated just because an unreal duality has been created here. Most beautiful way, perfection is there in this whole layout. Now, in this world of duality, all experiences are happening like that. When we return, if you will call it return, because there's no time space there, so the words are we using only applicable here, but to make a story. Supposing we have a home where there's all happiness and bliss, and here we have come, there is happiness, unhappiness, suffering. And by the way, if we study carefully, the happiness and unhappiness is quite pretty well divided. It doesn't look like it. We see some people very happy, some people very unhappy, some people very healthy, some people very unhealthy. So we think there's very uneven distribution. But if you study carefully, you'll find there are two types of high and low. Some are tangible. Somebody got a lot of money, or there's a poor. Some has got a new car, some has got an old car. Some is very healthy, some is very sick. These are tangible, visible things of differentiation. But then there are intangible things, like how much emotional stuff you get. There was a man who came to me in Boston. He said, why are you telling people that you have to leave this world and go somewhere? We have wonderful things here. He says, I have a beautiful house. I have lots of money. I just bought a new car. I have got everything that I need. Why would I go do meditation that you are telling me? I said, my friend, you don't need meditation. Go and enjoy. Enjoy your money. Enjoy your house. Enjoy your new car. Enjoy life. Your time is to enjoy, not to come to me at all. And next week he was back, crying. I am the worst sufferer in the world. I'm miserable. I'm depressed. What happened to you in 1 week? You were so happy last week. You don't know, my wife ran away with another man. And she left me. I loved her so much. And I can't. I said, better go and use a new your house. House has no value. I buy something with the money. Money has no value. What happened? One emotional distress destroyed the happiness of all the tangible things that he had. An intangible thing can create that. I used to hear about Lord Krishna, how as a child he used to give knowledge to Udo, his little friend. I decided to go to Vrindavan, Mathura, all that area I traveled where Krishna was living. So I found very poor people working in the fields, like gardeners. So tired after the day, they would sing in the evening. And they sang with so much happiness on their face. I've never seen the happiness on the faces of rich people. Their poverty did not affect them. So that is why, if you examine carefully how we are placed in the tangible and intangible things we have, the distribution is not very unfair. It's just that though more tangible things, I have had a chance to meet several people. Glamorous people appear in movies, Hollywood. I've seen their personal lives most miserable. They're suffering more than most of us at all. With all the money, all the fame, they cannot be happy. So that is why the distribution is not as bad as we think. But it's still a world of duality, of pairs of opposites. Supposing, for the sake of a story, our home is non-dual, only blissful stuff, only good stuff. And here we have both stuff, therefore it's bad stuff. And by the way, bad stuff looks very bad. Good stuff doesn't look so good. Reason, good stuff passes quickly. Bad stuff takes long. Supposing we are having a happy time with some people for 2 hours, it will look like 10 minutes. If you're suffering, 10 minutes will look like 2 hours. So that is why the state we are living in this physical world, suffering reduces the time. Oscar Wilde in one of his essays writes, the opening sentence is, suffering is one long moment. When time does not pass, you are suffering. If time passes quickly, you are happy. You are enjoying. So that is why it looks like suffering is more than enjoyment, because time passes differently over here. In the astral plane, we can stop time to enjoy something. But it's a little better than here. In the causal plane, you can travel on time. You discover time is laid out in one instant the whole time. And what we are doing here in the astral plane is not time is moving through us. We are moving on time from incident to incident. Discovery takes place at the causal plane. That is why time becomes totally different and completely reversible. Space and time can both go forward and backwards, which the scientists are trying to find here. But the inner experience can show you it is possible right there. So if we, after this experience, want to go back to our true home, and we find bulk of the souls that we left behind, trillion, we don't know how many they were. We were a small group that came here. We go back home. We are dancing with joy that we are back home. Look at the beauty. Look at the bliss of this home, what we are getting. Why? because we know what we had here. And the other souls say, what is so special about you? We are all in the same state of bliss, in the same place. Why are you dancing better than us? And we say, you don't know what you are missing. So we are very lucky to have an experience of the opposite here and then go back. In a book called Anurag Sagar, Ocean of Love, it's a dialogue between Kabir and his Dharmdas, his disciple. And the dialogue he's describing story-like, in a story-like this creation, and he calls the souls that have never left their true home a bunce. Those have come here and gone back as hunts. He says when the hunts go back to the bunts cannot imagine why the hunts are more happy than them, why they are in greater state of bliss than they are. And that's when they tell them, you do not know what you have. You've never seen its opposite. So that is why we who are here and have gone through this phase are actually very lucky. Especially we are lucky when we have a way to go back home when we want. Can you imagine that it is not that we have to wait till we wake up one day? We have, when we want to awaken, the seeking comes from the soul inside this body. That we want to wake up, a perfect living master appears in our life. We don't find one. We can't find one. How can you find? There's no label on him. There's no nothing written on his forehead that he's a master or not. And there are thousands of fake masters around claiming to be perfect living masters. How can you find one? In this labyrinth of masters over here, great master used to say, it appeared that there are more masters than disciples now today. So if that is the situation, how can you find a master? Moreover, a perfect living master who comes to take us back to our true home never says he's a master. He doesn't have to say it. He's come for a job, he'll do it. Why? Is he come to make a religion? Is he come to make societies, make something here? Is he come to make people's lives better? If that were so, he'll declare, I've come for that. But if his job is to take us out of this experience of the three worlds to our true home, why would he say that? He'll just pick us up with his love. He will appear where we are. And how do we know he has appeared? Because he will appear by a series of coincidences in our life. One thing happening, heard from here, saw this book, something, and he appears. I used to see great master. People appeared from America, Africa, Europe, South India, all places where he never went. But one thing led to the other, and when they reached there, they had a feeling, this is where we belong. An American doctor, Dr. Julian Johnson, when he came to this country, he did not come to see the great master. He came to convert Indians, Hindus into Christianity. He came as a minister to convert people into a new religion, which he believed in. And he was posted by his mission from United States to Calcutta. So he was in Calcutta when he heard from his friends, the first one who they knew about great master, Mr. and Mrs. Brock, they informed through somebody that there is a master here, you should see him. And he, believing in Jesus Christ as the Savior, was helping people in Calcutta. But he said, I will go and see him just once. To see why are people in my country talking about him. So he wrote to the great master. He wrote, I have understood from my friends that I should see you, that you are a spiritual person. I am very happy to see you. Tell me, when can I come? Great master, through his secretary, wrote, you can come by train. There's a frontier mail. There's a mail going direct from Calcutta. It comes all the way. And it doesn't stop where my dera is, in Bias River. So you can stop at Jalandhar, Kant, which is a town before that, or in Amritsar. Wherever place you want to come, I'll send you a car to pick up. But I recommend you stop at Jalal Darkan because that comes before the Dera. So you save some time. Moreover, a good friend of mine named Bhagat Singh, who's an attorney, he speaks English and he lives very close to the railway station, so he can pick you up. Since not many foreigners travel on this train, he can easily recognize you. There's a letter, Judy and Johnson traveled by train to come and see the master. What did master do in the meantime? He said, let's play a little trick on him. People can't imagine that masters are like that. I've seen, he was a very mischievous and clever master. If I tell you all the stories, you'll be surprised. He's a perfect living master, I can tell you. I'm telling you from experience. He was a perfect living master. So he said to Bhagat Singh, Bhagat Singh, let's give a surprise to this guy coming from America, that when he comes, he'll be tired after the long journey, and you tell him that, Dr. Johnson, you are very tired after a long journey. Come to my house, it is just next door, and have a cup of tea, some refreshment, and then we'll drive to the Dera, 25 miles away, so we'll be able to see the master there. And great master said, he will say, no, I have not come for a cup of tea. I want to see this man. I've come for that. Then you say, no, I'll take you home. Then he will get very irritated. He'll get very irritated, say, no, I've not come for this, but you still bring him home. In the state of irritation, you bring him home, say, I'm going to give you a cup of tea. And great master said, I will meantime come and hide in your house. I'll be hiding in your drawing room, living room of your house. So when he's really upset, you bring him, say, Dr. Johnson, I have a surprise for you. The master is here. And it's exactly what happened. Julian Johnson arrived at the station. Bhagat Singh received him and said, come to the house. He got irritated. And when he brought him a little irritation, he said, I have a surprise for you. And took him inside. The great master was sitting there on a chair. Julian Johnson was so struck by seeing the master. He couldn't speak. He just sat there on another chair, said, Master, you took the trouble of coming all the way to see me here. Great master said, you traveled thousands of miles to see me. I only came 25 miles. That night, Julian Johnson wrote a letter to his friends back in America. He said, I have met the man that you recommended to me. What I have got in 2 hours of his company, if I get nothing more, I've got all I wanted. How can that happen? To a missionary coming to convert people to another religion, he sees him and just spends a little time with him, and he can write a letter like that. He knew what he has been waiting for all his life, maybe many lives, for that moment. So many of us feel like that. We don't feel all the time. We feel we have arrived when that pull of love, that special feeling. What is the feeling? Where is it coming from? It's not coming from a mind. It's not coming from thinking. It's not coming from touch. It's coming from soul to soul. It's exact at the highest level. The soul is responding to the soul. Life is responding to life, not mind, not thinking, not senses, not body. So that is why these masters come to take us when we're ready, and when we meet them, we find that's what we are waiting for. It's happened so many times that people come and say, this is it. So that is why perfect living masters don't come to teach us. Then why do they say, do meditation? Why are they saying, do meditation a certain way? They are saying that simply so that we can create enough faith, enough belief that we are on the right track. To validate, the mind needs validation all the time. They say to validate, no amount of discussion outside will validate it. Go inside and validate. There's something more inside. And when you withdraw your attention inside, become unaware of outside, it's validated. The more you go, the more validation. And the more validation, the more faith. Faith that comes from the love and validation like this is so powerful. that the mind that keeps on doubting, the mind never stops doubting. Little thing happens that's not pleasant to the mind, it created doubt. People have come, satsangis have come to me. We have unshakable faith in the master. Next day, their son died in an accident. How could my master not save my son? I lost faith. My faith is shaken. This kind of faith does not come just like that by thinking about it. Faith comes when the doubts and all these are overridden by the love and the little validation that he gives us. Sometimes we come to these masters and very first time, a nice experience. Faith comes. There is something there. And then we wait, why can't we get the experience again? As years pass by, we were so lucky when we got initiated, or just even before that, we had such a wonderful spiritual experience. Why doesn't it come now? We're trying so hard. Because it was merely a gift given to generate basic faith. So we can move on. So I am sharing these things with you. Why have come to share these things with you as part of my seva to my master? It's not that I feel that there's something to be shared in Dubai or anywhere else. It's just, it simply happens that great master who initiated me at a very young age. I was only a little over 9 years. He's initiated, I was born in 1926, initiated me in 1936. Most of you were not even born then when I was initiated. So since I've had a long period of initiation, early on, I was a rebel against the master. Because somebody had told my parents, that you made a big mistake on getting your son initiated so early, when he'll grow up, you'll see how he'll react. Is he just forced into initiation because of his parents? And so, you wait and see. They gave example of Bhagat Singh's son. The same Bhagat Singh, so close to great master, his own son, who's an attorney today. And he was initiated at age 11. When he grew up, he said, that was nonsense. It's just my father forced me into it. There's no truth in it. So, they said, that'll happen to this boy of yours. So, I had overheard that conversation. I said, why should I wait for that? I am not convinced even now. So I spent several years investigating if what he said is true or not. And especially because when he initiated me, I still remember he used these words, I am giving you what I received from my master Baba Jamal Singh. It has worked for me. I hope it will work for you. If it does not, find anything better. And if you find anything better, please come and tell me. I will also take it. These are great master's words. I said, I'll take it seriously. I'll go and find something better and tell him. I've been trying to find something better till today. Haven't found anything better. If I find, I'll try and tell him as best as I can. I will certainly take it and follow it. These are his instructions. So that is why many years in my college days, I was just searching. Got converted to different religions. Followed so many yogis, swamis, I think I have met more gurus than anybody I know of. That is why did I go through all that? I had no idea. At that time, I had no idea. Now I have an idea. Because now I have friends all over the world following the very thing that I was going into. The yogis come, talk to me about the yoga, and I can tell them exactly what they are doing. Because I did it. So it was actually developing a certain awareness in me, which is coming handy now at this late stage in my life while I'm doing seva for master. Seva is doing something for your guru, for your master, without expecting any reward. If you're expecting something back, that's not seva. That's a business transaction. Seva should be done like that. I remind some of my friends that when I was very small, in the Dera, great master, there was no electric power there, and there used to be some sevadar fanning him. One day, I said, why can't I fan him also? That's a big seva, it's very personal. He stands behind the great master, he's giving a discourse, and he's fanning him. Big fan. So I crept on the stage, and I tried to ask for the fan, and the sevadar scolded me. Get down, You're too small for this. Get down. I want the fan. So he said, no, get down. And great master, who just looked at me, smiled and said, give him the fan. I can never forget this. Looks like it happened just 5 minutes ago. It's so clear in my memory. So I got up and I took the fan and I fanned great master. And I felt, what a beautiful seva I've got. What was the reward I was thinking of? For the seva. That was the reward. Not something that will come because I'm doing that. Therefore, I discover now that was seva. I did fanning great master. Later on, when I grew up, I joined some politics or something. Great master wanted the road from the railway station to the Dera built up. So I went to the British engineers and got that done up. That was also seva. He gave me small tasks all over throughout my life. And every one, I was so happy to do the seva. I'm doing the same thing today. What I'm sharing with you is experiential. It's not from books. It's based on his teachings and following his teachings. Therefore, it's seva to him. But because it's seva to him, I happen to become, incidentally, your sevadar also. So I can share these experiences with you. These are all something that you can validate. But secret, go in. Don't talk about it. Talk less, do more. You must try these things. And if there is a problem that you are not making any headway, get help from anywhere. Don't get stuck. Don't say, oh, for 40 years I've been trying it, nothing is happening. Why didn't you get more help? There are people who have achieved something. You go to masters. You go to the masters and get help. You go to other advanced disciples of masters. They can help. But do not think it is merely a blind belief. Great master Baba Sawan Singh said, there is no scope for andhvishwas, blind faith in spirituality. It should be based only on your experience. Supposing you have a little experience only, believe that. Don't dismiss the rest because you haven't had the experience. Doesn't mean it doesn't exist. But it is not your experience. You have to wait till you get more. If you go on that basis, you will make progress slowly. As progress is made, it becomes your own experience, and faith should be based on that experience. It should be a living faith, not a dead faith. A dead faith is somebody says, there is God sitting up there, worship him. And we believe in. Do you believe in God? Yes. Why? So-and-so said this. That dead belief never changes. Somebody said, I'm believing. Living faith grows like living things. Every time you have one more experience, the faith grows. And when we say experience, don't think experience is only what you see inside. Experience can be outside. You can have experiences where you feel this could not have happened. Has happened. Must be his grace. It could not have happened otherwise. Small miracles happen, which we can't explain. They are against the laws of probability, but they happen. And the only thought comes, there must be some intervention, divine intervention, to get this happen. These are all experiences. They all add up, both internal and external. And that's how the faith is built up. Have faith based on experience, internal and external, not blind faith. I'm very happy that you were able to come and join me, and I was able to stop in Dubai for a day and share this information, share these experiences with you. I hope they'll be of some value to you and useful in your own spiritual journeys. Thank you very much. We'll take a break now. I'll take up a few questions that you have asked and sent in writing. Try to answer them.
As I was listening to Ishwarji speak, I noticed his hands were glowing a bright orange color. I was sure at first that it was the lighting, but when I moved my head around left to right while looking directly at him, they were still glowing a bright orange. However, when I looked directly at the hands, they did not glow. I shut my eyes a few times and I would see a half orange sky, which later on during the lecture Ishwar ji spoke about seeing a golden sun and orange sunset sky in the meditation. I have never had such an experience, so I would love to know if there is anything behind such a vision.
That's a long question. Thank you. As I was listening to me, I noted his hands were glowing a bright orange color. I just rubbed some color before coming, you know. That's to confuse you, right? But only one saw that. I'm glad. I was sure at first that it was the lighting. But when I moved my head around left to right, and while looking directly at him, they were still glowing a bright orange. Hence, when I looked directly at the hand, they did not glow. I shut my eyes a few times, and I would see a half-orange sky, which later on, during the lecture, Ishwar spoke about seeing a golden sun and orange sunlit sky in the meditation. I never had such an experience. I would like to know if there is anything behind such vision. Well, you guessed right that the vision you had was just a glimpse of the causal plane, which is our own mind. Sometimes what holds us inside from the glimpses is only our attention outside. When we think of something in our mind, sometimes the glimpses can come from the mind. And when those glimpses come, we are able to see some of the things that we describe at different levels of consciousness. So what happened was merely a small glimpse of the causal sky, which is golden orange, exactly as you saw. And when that shines, also some of the parts of our physical body appear to be like that. When you are there, the whole of you also glows. But it is not merely hands, but in that state, the whole body glows in the orange color because of the reflection from the golden sky. So it was just a very good glimpse, and I congratulate you. Obviously, you are in a very good state to meditate deep and go into that state. Congratulations.
Is ambition the opposite to spirituality? Can we have both?
Is ambition the opposite of spirituality? Can we have both? I understand by ambition, you are referring to ambition for things in the world. If by ambition you mean more desire to get things in the world, then it is opposite. Because we should desire, seek something which is our true home, which is inside, not outside. But if ambition is merely a passion to do something, then that passion to do something and rise in that can be transferred very quickly to a passion inside. I'll tell you a little story. There was a gang of robbers in India, and they were robbing different places. They discovered in those days that in the Dera where great master lived and taught his teachings, they were building a large hall, satsanghar, which will have golden minarets, and those will be really gold-plated. So people were donating gold, especially the ladies were giving away their gold jewelry as donation, so that this can be used in that building. So this gang thought that is a very easy target, because they are just collecting the jewelry, gold jewelry. It should be easy to go and rob them. There does not seem to be much security in the Dera. It's a small Dera. So they sent one of their guys, whose name was Shadi, a Muslim guy, who was given the task of doing a reconnaissance, go and check where the gold is, then we can go in one sweep and just collect the gold. It is not put up on the building yet. So Shadi came and saw that the time at which he came was when the great master was giving a discourse. He used to give discourses in the evening also. It was 5 o'clock in the afternoon. So he went to various little small houses that were there at that time, and he asked the ladies in one house, why are you not going to satsang? Great master is giving satsang. They said, no, they left us here so we can take care of the gold. Where is the gold? It's lying right there in that basket. They were surprised, completely unsecured. The gold is lying in a basket. Then he went to another house. Some children were playing. They said, what are you doing here? Oh, we have been told to take care of that box that contains gold. Within a few minutes, he found it the easiest place to rob gold here. Nobody is securing it. There is no lock or key. Everybody seems to have just left it and gone to listen to the master. So thought came in his head, how is it possible that people who are leaving such a valuable thing like their gold, totally unsecured, just to go and listen to a man who's just giving a discourse? What kind of man that would be? So this curiosity took him to the place where great master was giving a discourse. So he stood at the back, and as he stood there, great master was saying that the naam, the word inside, the shabd inside, which has created everything, it is in all of us, including robbers and gangsters. He looked at him, he recognized me. How does he know I am here? He's talking of that power being in the gangster. So he said, I have to ask him this question. So he did not leave and waited for the discourse to end. When it ended, he ran to the master and said, Master, how did you know I am a robber? He said, I don't know anything about you. Don't tell me that. You recognize me. You looked at me and said that Naam is in the robber also and gangster also. You knew who I was. How did you know? He said, I don't know. But then why did you say that? Great Master said, I say it every day in my discourses. There's nothing special about it. And he said, no, this is not so. Therefore, he said, I am not going to go away till I find an answer. How did you find out? And you say that power which made you say that is the one you are praising. It's the power of Naam, power of that Shabd. I want to know what that is. So he did not go back to the gang at all. He stayed on and began to ask the great master a number of questions. And great master said, you can stay here, satisfy yourself, but you have to do some work here because everybody is working here. You can't be just a beggar eating food and doing nothing in the dera. Everybody does some seva. What seva can you do? He said, only thing I learned was how to rob people. He said, no, you can't do rob in the dera. Don't you know anything else? And Shadi said, the one thing I know is that we have a getaway truck. And when the truck breaks down, I am the only party in the gang who can set the armature of the electric system right. I can rewire it very quickly. So my information about working with the gang is only about that. Great Master said, I found a job for you. Set up a generator and provide electricity in that era. So Great Master gave him the fund, and we set up a diesel engine motor and a generator which ran with a leather trap. So because it was very interesting, first time we saw, as a child saw, so I used to help him to start the engine. We used to pull leather belt. I used to help him pulling the belt. I still remember. Shadi became such a devoted person. His whole passion, ambition to be a great robber, became ambition to be find the truth inside. He just switched. Whatever was a great passion for something outside became a passion inside. He made more progress faster than most of us. And that is why the great master used to tell him, tell Shadi what you saw today, which he normally would say, don't tell anybody. That's just the experiences. But he would ask Shadi to tell in open satsang. So Shadi would tell where he had reached, and he was very curious to find out if these prophets were real in the history, and he could go back in time and see those prophets. He went back all the way and saw Jesus Christ. He saw a lot of things in history. He was very interested in that. So then he would share his experiences that he used to hear. He became so close to great master. He became his bodyguard. He began to travel with him. He provided the electric power in the day of first light was set up in great master's house. One lamp just from the generator. And today, of course, things are very different. The big township today, there's a start of that era. So Shadi became such a wonderful satsangi, wonderful disciple, because the whole passion he had to do something outside was switched to going inside, just with one meeting with that perfect master. So these things happen in life. If your ambition is not merely desire to do more things in life, but to do something with passion, it can be switched. The other thing is that if you are a satsangi, follower of a master, and want to go within yourself, does it mean that you have to lose interest in your jobs? Do you have to lose interest in what you're doing outside? Some people are of that opinion, well, to go inside, you have to give up outside. Absolutely wrong. To go inside, you should be equally efficient outside. Bhagavan Krishna says that if you want to be a real yogi, yoga karma su kaushalam, your action should be done with the utmost skill. Use your best skill to do outside work, but it becomes spiritual if you don't expect a reward for it. The whole thing is no fruit. Don't expect fruit from your actions. It becomes yoga. So that is why great master said, if you have duties to do in this world, do them with their best skill and rise in life. Rise inside, rise in life. There's no contradiction at all. You can do both. But some people tell me, when we give all our attention and interest to worldly jobs, then we can't remember master, we can't remember simran, we can't do meditation. I advise them, if that happens, do one simple thing. Make a decision in your mind, your master is doing everything. Your guru is doing everything, even outside. So when you are doing your work skillfully, you are saying master doing everything. That takes away that mind and ego out of it by bringing master into everything you do. If that doesn't work, then master said, think that what you are doing outside and inside both is seva for your master. Not for earning your living, not for this thing. Everything is seva for master. What you are getting is a reward from master. These are just a way of affirmations in our own head. If you start living like that, no problem. If ambition means success in life, be as successful as you can be. Great master never said, stop working and come and sit here. He said, work to your best ability. Do the best in this world and the best inside. But remember, if you remember the master as seva, or that he is doer of everything, it's as good as meditation. So you could be meditating all day while you're doing your work outside by remembering master. Meditation is not merely a mechanical exercise. Repeating words has taken nobody anywhere. Meditation is to meditate on the spiritual truth. What is spirituality? If you want to know, I'll quote great master. He said, spirituality starts with the master, continues with the master, and with the master. As simple as that. Your association with the master is spirituality. Your remembering the master is spirituality. That the master will pull you. The love grows when you remember the master. That love that you're experiencing is the pull coming from your own inside, expressed outside from a master. So that's the whole spirituality.
Why is it so difficult to control the mind when I try to meditate?
Why is it so difficult to control the mind when I try to meditate? Because the mind likes to enjoy things outside. Mind likes to go more out, more into desires, more into what it is attached to. The more desire it has, the more attached it gets, want to go back, wants more and more of outside. When you want to control the mind, mind says no. Can we control the mind at all? This question I asked great master once. I said, Master, every satsangi of yours that I have met says, mind does not let me meditate. Every time I try to meditate, the mind takes me out. Even when I do simran, few minutes I do, and mind is thinking of something else. Is it possible to control the mind? Great master gave an answer. He said, there was once upon a man, he said, if a man is born who claims he has been able to lift the mountains of the Himalayas, I know it's not possible. One moment I will believe, maybe such a man has been born. If somebody comes and says, I drank all the water of the oceans, which is impossible, for one moment I might believe such a man can exist. But if a man comes and says, I have controlled my mind, I'll say, no, no, no. That's the answer he gave. He says, mind cannot be controlled. Mind cannot stop thinking. Mind cannot stop thinking of outside things. Therefore, to think that you can control the mind, there are two ways in which you can be helped a little bit. First way is to develop a spiritual will as opposed to mental will. Mind desires things a lot. Mind falls into temptations a lot. Mind keeps on going into temptations, and mind keeps on doing the same things which we have said, we'll never do it again. Now here's a small audience here. I'd like to ask you, has it ever happened in your life that you decided, I'll never do it again, and still did it? Please raise your hand if you have done this. Everybody. It's so common. Mind cannot be controlled. That is why there are two ways of doing. First way is, when the mind desires something very bad, to control the mind, say no. Mind says, just once more, no. If you can hold that no, you will see the mind will become under some control. Not too much, some control. But you have to hold the no till the end. Not give up after the mind presses. Most of the time, mind pressure will give in. Because the temptation, the argument the mind brings up is so convincing, we just let go. Decide for those things which the mind wants a lot. Say no, not on everything. Only 3-4 times a week, your spiritual will develop. Now imagine, when mind is wanting something, what power in you can say no? And people have said no. Who is saying no? Is the same mind saying no to itself? Not really. It is your soul that wants to go in, is instructing the mind to say to itself no. And you hold the no, and mind comes under control. The second method, which is more pragmatic, more practicable, is one to learn to ignore the mind. When you're meditating, you stay focused on one thing. If you're focused on something, mind is thinking, withdraw your attention from the thoughts that are going on and focus on what you're doing. This will become easy if before meditation, you have a practice for several days of watching your mind. That's another type of meditation. To watch your own mind. That means to watch your own thoughts. If you sit here behind the eyes in the third eye center and decide not to think, mind will still think. You decided not to think, sitting just quiet, and you will see the mind is still speaking, mind is making pictures in front of you, remembering things. Watch quietly. Watch the mind at work. You will discover after some meditation of this kind, you are not the mind. You are an observer of the mind. You are now watching the mind at work. That's important to know that. Once you know you are not the mind, and you are able to watch the mind, then it becomes easy after that, during meditation, to ignore the mind. So, to ignore the mind and to develop spiritual will, two methods of controlling the mind effectively enough to make your meditation better. One more question.
I believe that I have faith, but I also know that it gets shaken up quite often, more so recently. While it may take me some time to go inwards and find answers, if at the physical level the master says his role is not to resolve worldly issues, and yet the path is about living faith, how does this dilemma get answered?
I believe that I have faith, but I also know it gets shaken up often, more so recently. While it may take me time to go inwards and find answers, if at the physical level the master says his role is not to resolve worldly issues and yet the path is about living faith, how does this dilemma get answered? It appears to me that different masters are different answers given to these questions. I can only tell you what great master said. He was my master. By what he promised and delivered, I call him a perfect living master. And his answer was, a disciple is a friend of the master. And a friend can ask a friend any question. There's no restriction whatsoever. Therefore, I had the opportunity to ask great master Baba Savan Singh any question, internal or external, that bothered me. And he would answer that. He would give me advice on how to do that. My friends who today ask me questions, there are so many questions they ask about worldly affairs, how to handle the loss of faith because of things that happen in the world. Tragedies occur, they shake our faith. How to handle them? I give them answers which I obtained from great master. Somebody once said, how do you have all the answers? Do you read books at night? A young child especially asked me, you must be reading books at night. I see that you give answers. By the way, that young child was my own granddaughter. And I said, no, I shared a secret with her. The secret was, I don't give answers. The master inside me gives answers. People cannot see the master because physically he died. In 1948, 2nd April he died. Nobody can see him. But I can see him because he initiated me sitting inside. Therefore, I know he gives the answers. I speak them out. Sometimes he even stops me from speaking out. He says, I can speak it. Who are you to speak? Once or twice I have been scolded, thinking I can give answers. Who am I to give answers? These are all answers coming from great master who sits inside. That is why you noticed I come and I give answers to people all over the world without any knowledge at all. I am nobody, personally. My master Baba Savan Singh is everything. People said, when do you prepare your talks? You are giving talks and we hear you on YouTube. And do you ever prepare your talks? I said, never. I have never prepared any talk, never even thought of what I am going to say. And by the way, that's not very good news for me. After I've spoken, I don't even know what I said. So, I'm just a robot in a way. So far as great master's work is concerned, so far this seva, the great master is concerned, he's doing it himself. You can't see that, therefore you see me. But actually, great master. We were sitting on a table the other night in Delhi and somebody said, when you look into our eyes, we see you, but sometimes we feel great master. I said, when I see you, you think I am looking at you. When you see me, do you know who sees you from the same eyes? Then somebody said, great master. I said, yes. It's great master, see. It's very difficult to explain this. This strange phenomenon. But since it is happening, therefore, I have shared the secret with you that I don't give any answers, all great masters' answers. So that is why it is very important to know what the role of a master becomes when you get initiated. So it is the master inside who gives all the answers. It's the master inside who is doing everything. That comes when you are doing seva for master, by him. That's the simple truth. So I'm very happy to share this secret with you. It's a secret. Please don't tell anybody. And if you feel like telling somebody, please tell them not to tell anybody else. Thank you very much.